Good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's Live with Bucky Live session. Thank you so much for joining us. Tonight, we are going to be talking about all things university housing move-in. excuse me. We have staff from our Res Life, DASH Services, Facilities, and also one of our student housing ambassadors here to talk about residence hall move-in and what the process will look like this year. We will also be answering any of your questions live today. So if you have anything that you would like to know, drop them into the live comment section of this video and we will get to you very shortly. We see that some of you have already started dropping questions in here, so that's great. Just keep them coming. I also wanted to mention that if you would like to watch a replay of this live stream after it's over, or view any of our other Live with Bucky Live sessions, be sure to check out our Live with Bucky Live page. You can find that at go.wisc.edu/livewithbuckylive. I will mention too, we did do a live stream on move-in last week as well, and it's a great session, especially if you're really wanting to know about COVID-related precautions. We did have Dr. Carol Griggs from University Health Services with us to answer those questions. So that is a great one to watch as well if you're looking for more information. So before we dive into questions, I just want to introduce who our panel is here with us today. So I'm going to go ahead and start with myself. So hi, everyone. My name is Sarah, and I'm part of the marketing and communications team here at University Housing. So with that, I'm going to pass it on over to Amanda.
Welcome, everyone. My name is Amanda. I work in residential operations. I oversee all of our front desks, which includes all of our mail and packages. And I also oversee all of our move-in procedures, which is why I'm here today with you. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Tanya.
Hi, good evening, everyone, and welcome. My name is Tanya, and I'm an assistant director for Residence Hall Facilities. Our area oversees the maintenance and cleaning, access control of all of your residence hall and dining spaces. And with that, I'll pass it on to Rachel.
Hi, everyone. My name is Rachel Zisman. I'm a Residence Life Coordinator here on campus, which means I work with a lot of the student staff. I help support their students in their transition to college, and I work in the unit. So I'm going to pass it off to Eric, who's one of our housing ambassadors.
Hi, everyone. I'm Eric. I'm a second year student. I'm a housing ambassador. I'm also majoring in nursing and pursuing a certificate in public policy. A housing ambassador or a first student, as you will see when coming into housing, we answer questions. Any concerns or questions you have about housing, room assignments, or anything of that nature, and yes.
So thanks a lot, Eric. So as you can see, we've got a great panel of people here ready to just dive into your questions. So with that, I'm just going to give you another reminder. Tonight, we're talking about move-in. So if you have a question, please drop it in. We're going to get to the comment section of this video, and we're going to get to it actually in just a moment. We are actually going to try to answer as many questions as we can tonight. If by chance we don't get to your question or you just have an additional question after this session is over, feel free to still hit us up with that question. Be sure to check out our contact us form. So you can find that at go.wisc.edu/housing-contact. So with that, I actually am going to kick it off here with Amanda and Tanya. So Amanda, move-in is just around the corner here. What are the basics that families and residents should know?
Yeah, so our main move-in dates are August 31st through September 2nd. We have August 30th also available for our bigger halls, so Witte, Celery, our Cronsage areas, and Og. And some students will be approved for an earlier move-in date, typically August 29th. Housing employees, employees for student campus, or for campus and other groups. When you come to campus, we are asking all visitors will need masks. So students and visitors need to be masked at all times inside. Students need to bring a valid government issued ID, and that's going to be used to verify your identity when you get there to move in. And if you submitted your picture for your WISC card prior to August 23rd, that will also get you your WISC card when you move in and check in at our table. We ask that you also bring your printed parking permit, which you can find in the move-in section of My UW Housing. You'll need to print that out for your car so that we are directing you to the right place to park. And then just the typical things, bed sheets, blankets, pillows. Everyone should bring water. We'll have water filling stations in our halls, but you'll want to bring water because it's probably going to be a hot one. We do ask that people bring rubber mallets to assist with any lofting of the beds. You don't have to bring one. We have limited supplies in our halls, but it may just be helpful for you to bring that. But ultimately, if you look at the What Bucky Would Bring list on our website, you're going to find lots of helpful information and things to bring, some things that you shouldn't bring that are not allowed. All of that will help you.
Thanks a lot, Amanda. So those are really good basics for you to kind of, as you're coming here, what to be prepared for. So Tanya, we've got those basics. So now we're coming here. So where am I going to park? What do I do? What's my next step?
Yeah. So on the housing kind of move-in website with all the great details, there's a link called the Fall Move-In Map. And I recommend clicking on that and saving that to your phone or your mobile device, because what that's going to do is Google Map all your check-in locations. So as you can see here on the screen, there's lots of little diagrams here on the Google Map, but the yellow star is going to be your starting point of your check-in location. That's going to direct you to where you will be directed to park near your residence hall, get your key. And then once you do that, you will get your WISC card, your key, a swag bag with some goodies in it, and get unloaded. The unloading time frame is only 90 minutes. We need to get people parked near the residence halls and then move to long-term parking if you're choosing to stay in Madison, spend some more time in the room, so we can get that next wave of students in. So if you look at the green boxes on the map and click on those are instructions and directions for long-term parking on the day that you've moved in. So once you've unloaded the vehicle, you can go back to your map, click on this green box, and that will direct you to the long-term parking spot that is free as long as you exit the ramp by 9 p.m. on the day that you arrive. Blue boxes are kind of area campus or city ramps that will be pay tickets. Sometimes families do that because it's just a little bit easier to get to. We did a really good job marking. We have a lot of one-ways and street closures that are somewhat normal to the move-in process, and in addition to some extended utility projects that are still going on campus. So just be mindful of those and be patient with those as we're navigating the traffic, especially in the southeast side. And we will do our best to get you parked and unloaded as quickly as possible.
Thanks a lot, Tanya. So we've got some parking questions coming in here. So I think you're the perfect person to take care of those for us. So this first one here is from Olivia. And Olivia is asking, if you are bringing two cars, are you able to just print out two parking permits? So again, what are you really asking people to do if they brought two vehicles? Say one's stocked with things and one is stocked with people.
Sure. Regardless of what it's stocked with, you will need a parking permit because you will need that printed permit from your portal to get into the long-term parking ramps. So both of you will need it. If you have a car of just people, we are asking that you go straight to the long-term parking areas and walk up to the residence hall so that we can make sure that there's enough parking spaces near the residence hall for everyone who's actively unloading a vehicle full of room items. So you can certainly do that. We're just asking to not bring more than one vehicle, if possible, of people unloading at that residence hall.
Thanks a lot, Tanya. So feel free to bring two vehicles. Just one goes in the unloading zone, and then the additional vehicles will need to go to long-term parking. So that's a good rule of thumb. Thanks a lot, Tanya. So Amanda, we have a question here for you from Amy. And Amy is asking, to confirm, is the WISC card at the dorm check-in provided the student uploaded their photo by August 23rd, not the student union, correct?
Yeah, great question, Amy. That is correct. So provided that the student gave that photo before the 23rd, All of those are being printed actually right now, and will be delivered to the halls this weekend. And so they will be there when students move in. If those cards are not there because the photo was not provided, the students will have to go to the WISC card office. That office will be open limited hours on Sunday this week, and then throughout the week when we're moving in.
Sounds good. Thanks, Amanda. Actually, I have one more question for you here. So this a question comes to us from Chrissy, and Chrissy is asking, when can we start to receive packages at our dorm address?
Yeah.
I know this is a popular one.
This is a popular one. And I know because we're getting a ton of packages right now from folks. We are receiving packages from students currently. We're not sending anything away. We do ask, because of our limited space, that you're just not shipping anything more than 1 week prior to the student's move-in date, which we know is right now. So you can start sending that stuff. We just ask that you follow this format here for shipping packages of their full name, first and last, their room number, residence hall, the address, and Madison, Wisconsin, and their zip code. All of this information can be found on the student's MyUW housing. When you go to that site, it usually is on the left-hand side, and that is the address you want to use.
Thanks a lot, Amanda. So, Rachel, I'm going to bring you in here. Lots of questions I'm seeing on this on variations. So, you're coming to campus. There's some COVID precautions in place, right? What should residents and families expect when they get here, kind of related to what COVID precautions are currently happening?
Of course. Yeah, I can talk about some of the COVID precautions that we have in place. So first, masking requirements are on campus. Obviously, masks are required to be worn on campus indoor at all times when you're outside your room, unless, you know, the activity directly prohibits it, like brushing your teeth or something like that. So I do suggest that students bring a few masks with them just to make sure they have a variety going into the year. Required testing for before move-in for unvaccinated students is still happening. All unvaccinated students must have a COVID test, a PCR test, prior to their residence hall move-in date. These tests have to be submitted via the MyUHS portal before they arrive. If you test positive, you will need to isolate for 10 days, and you should isolate where you are, like at home, or if you're traveling, you should isolate where you are before you come to campus. And if you're negative, you can move in on your assigned date. If you don't complete the testing and submit the results prior to arrival, you won't be allowed to move in. So make sure if you're unvaccinated that you're following all the expectations around testing prior to your arrival. Required move-in testing for unvaccinated students. Also, if you're unvaccinated, all students who are unvaccinated or all residents will need to schedule a COVID-19 test on campus for their move-in day. The appointment time can be after their check-in time, but they will need to do it that day. And if appointments aren't available, they'll just be able to schedule it the next day. So if they have a late check-in shift or something. So you just need to do it right after they arrive or right before, right around when they arrive. And then if you're also unvaccinated, you need to continue testing. There'll be more instructions for all students around that, but all unvaccinated students will need to continue testing weekly throughout the school year until they're fully vaccinated. And at any time, if they test positive for COVID-19, they will or have a possible exposure, unvaccinated students will need to be placed in isolation and quarantine housing. Upload your vaccination record. If you are vaccinated, definitely remember to submit your vaccination record, and please upload them to the UHS app as soon as possible. It looks like we're pulling up the UHS portal right now, but definitely make sure that you log in and share that information so you can, you know, kind of skip all these steps. So
thanks a lot, Rachel. Super important stuff there to go over. So keep in mind, if you did not upload your vaccination records by the deadline that we had communicated with you, which was August 16th, UHS may not have had time to process those right now. And you may still have some processing or testing you may need to go until that vaccination record is uploaded. So if you have questions, you should direct those to UHS. They are the ones that handle those records. We don't have those here in university housing. So that's a great resource. And as we showed on the screen, all of those directions are there on how to do that. And UHS's contact information is also available. So really important stuff, Rachel. Thanks for sharing. With that, we do have some questions, and I actually have one for you. So this question is for you, Rachel. It's from Veronica, and it's about our WISC card. So how soon can students receive their WISC card, and when do they start using them? So Amanda shared that if they had their stuff uploaded by the 23rd, their photo, they'll get it at check-in, right? So kind of how do you use your WISC card?
Yeah, so students use it for a lot of things. Probably the most prevalent thing that they use is for either entry to the buildings or using it in the dining center. So we have prox access for all the buildings' main entrances. So you just kind of hold it up to this gray box, the door will unlock, and you can enter. So it works like a key. And then we also use it for the dining center. So that's where students' meal plans will be loaded onto. They can go to Flamingo Run or the dining centers, that sort of stuff, using their WISC card.
Perfect. And I do think they use the WISC cards also for laundry, correct?
Oh, yes. I forgot to mention laundry. Yeah, they use it for laundry. And so, yeah, a whole bunch of stuff is loaded on there. And as someone had asked, when can they start using it? They can start using it right away when they get on campus.
Yeah, it's kind of like your passport to everything. So it's a good thing to keep a hold of. So thanks a lot, Rachel. So actually, I think this is another great question for you. So this comes to us from Sarah. Awesome name, can I just say? So Sarah is asking, what is the procedure for bringing a personal bike to the campus dorm? So Madison's a super bike friendly campus, right? So lots of students use this. What do you usually see your residents doing?
Yeah, we see a lot of students bringing bikes. There's lots of resources online for information about bikes. I always suggest that students register their bikes with the city, just in case anything were to happen to it or anything like that. That can be super helpful. I also suggest that students bring a U-lock or a sturdy lock that they can keep their bikes with them. But there are bike racks everywhere on campus. And so there's a lot of opportunities for them to park right outside on the buildings or right next to their residence hall. And it can be a really easy way to get around campus.
Awesome. Thanks a lot, Rachel. So be sure you bring those bikes. And also, if you don't have a bike, there all are B-cycle stations, which are also all over campus that students can also use, correct?
Yeah. Oh, yes. And they're really close to campus, which is really awesome. So, and they're motorized bikes or bikes that'll help you pedal, so you don't have to do quite all the work by yourself. So,
Hey, that sounds awesome to me. So thanks a lot, Rachel. So with that, actually, Eric, I'm going to bring you in here since you are our student expert here. We've got all sorts of questions coming in about kind of what happens when you're unloading your car and setting up your room. So after you're parked, right, you've unloaded your stuff, you're in your room. What happens next?
Oh, once you are checked in, just a reminder that you and your helpers have 90 minutes to unload your vehicle in the unloading zone. Once you check in, go to your hall, pick up any packages that you might have. If you need assistance with lofting your bed and moving or with anything else, there will be staff there to assist you. All your trash and recycling is your responsibility to remove from your room. Please take all styrofoam, cardboard, and plastic bags to recycling locations outside of your hall. To connect your device to UW-Net, UW-Madison wireless internet service, you can simply select it from the network list and launch it in any web browser. You'll automatically be redirected to a register page where you can enter your net ID information. Return your moving cards when you're done moving in because there will be people waiting for them. Just a note, students should not return to the unloading parking locations after shopping trips. Other lots are available, which are the long-term lots.
Perfect. Thanks a lot, Eric. So those are some good basics, right? You're unloaded. We're going to get you hooked up to the internet, and then we know you're going to go shopping. So just don't park back in that special unloading zone. So thanks a lot, Eric. We have some more questions coming in here, so I'm just going to dive right into them. So I think this question I'm going to have Rachel field for us. So this is from Chrissy. Chrissy is asking, are there Uber, Lyft, electric scooters allowed on campus? So again, transportation question. Lots of students use Uber and Lyft. Are we allowed to use those?
Of course. Yeah. Uber and Lyft are really popular on campus. I think a lot of students use those for longer trips or if they're going to, you know, a mall that's a little bit further away or off the bus route or something like that. But yeah, definitely Uber and Lyft are around and available on campus and definitely will be for move-in days if that's something that would be helpful to you.
Thanks a lot, Rachel. Appreciate that. So, Tanya, I'm going to bring you in for this one. This one comes to us from Sue. And Sue is asking, for the doubles that have been turned into triples in DeJope, can all three beds be lofted? And will there be three desks and three bookcases provided? So can you talk a little bit about what they should expect?
Yeah. So all the beds should be able to be lofted and rearranged based on kind of students' preference and how everyone wants to access things. There will be three desks, one for each resident, but there are no bookcases in DeJope. So there will not be bookcases. The compensation for that is kind of the shelving in the walk-in closets and other different furniture designs that are being modified as we continue to grow our program.
Perfect. Thanks a lot, Tanya. And if anyone wanted to just verify what furniture is provided, that's all listed on the furnishings section on our website. So we can pull that up here in a moment and show that to you. So that's at go.wisc.edu/housing-furnishings. You'll be able to see exactly what is provided. And as Tanya mentioned, DeJope does not have a bookcase provided. So that also says what isn't provided here. So we are pulling that up here in just a moment. So all of that. Another thing I will point out on this page, so here's all the items that are provided, really good resource, is right up above there on the menu, we have the lofting. So lots of lofting questions coming in here. This is going to be your guide to how to do that, right? And it shows you the typical three ways to do that. Also, this is all linked in the Wisconsin Welcome app if you have that for the Center for First Year Experience. So this will take you all there if you get on campus and you need to take a look at that. So that's all there as well. So good resources, that furnishings page. So thanks a lot, Tanya. Appreciate you answering that question for us. So for this one, actually, Tanya, I'm going to bring you back here. We've got another parking question. So this comes to us from Troy. Troy is asking, with the construction around Chadbourne, where will the parking be located? So I think anyone that's seen, there's still some utility projects that are going on campus right now, making sure that you've got good water and utilities, but it makes parking a little bit more chaotic for us. So can you talk about what to expect?
Yeah, we can expect unexpected adventures together. We will be closing down the section of Park Street from University to Langdon. So we will be actively parking cars on the southbound lane of Park Street and entering the building from that side and utilizing the northbound lane for some parking, unloading areas, but also to get any through traffic, employees, construction workers through that area as needed. But otherwise, on the active move-in days for Chadbourne, which is Sunday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, we will have that section of the street completely closed for move-in. If you are checking in a Barnard, it'll be helpful if you continue on to University and use that circle drive. We do have some limited spaces there that will help alleviate that traffic, but otherwise we will be utilizing Park Street primarily.
Yeah, so really important to check out that Google map. And also, when you have all the other things to bring, please bring your patience as well. We are all doing the best that we can with this. So anything you can do, it will help us all out in these red shirts. So thanks a lot, Tanya. Appreciate that. So our next question here is going to go to Amanda. It's about red carts, and it comes to us from Kyla. Kyla is asking, will the moving carts be available after move-in dates finish for moving and extra furniture and materials later? And do all of the dorms have elevators? So I think those red carts are super popular during move-in. If a student has a package, can they use those afterwards?
Yes, we will have a lot of red carts for move-in. And then after move-in, we will have a few red carts at the desk. So anytime anyone needs to move something or has lots of packages, we will have some available for checkout at the desk. We can always get more if we run out of them with a lot of people picking up a lot of packages.
Thanks a lot, Amanda. And just as a note, not all of our residence halls have elevators. Nothing to worry about, though. The flights, halls that do not have elevators, they don't have a lot of stairs. So, and plus cardio is really good for you, and you walk a lot on this campus. So plus, if you need help carrying something, just reach out to a house fellow or one of your fellow hallmates, and they're always willing to help. So that's what's really cool about living with us. So thanks a lot for the question, Kyla. I'm going to bring Rachel back in here. So Rachel, a couple questions for you that I think are right up your alley. This question comes to us from Dana, and Dana had a laundry question. So laundry, how should my child pay for laundry services? WISC card, quarters, both? So what should they expect? Again, can you just remind people?
Yeah, so you load a little bit of money, whatever you think your student might need, kind of depending on their needs, onto the WISC card, into the WISC account, and then they can use that. So no need to bring quarters or anything like that. And then just for your planning, students will pay for the wash cycle, but the dry cycle is free. So when they go to the laundry machines down in the basement, there'll be a little machine that they can swipe their card in, select the machine that they're going to use, and then run their clothes through there.
Great. So again, remember, the washers, I think, are $250. Don't quote me without that. And I'm sorry. Yes. Yeah. And then the dryers are free. So thanks a lot. So another question that we've got here. And actually, I think this is another Rachel question. So Rachel, this is coming to us from Hassan. And Hassan is asking, can you speak about transportation via bus from residence halls to classes? And how do you get, I think he says, free AMC pass, but I believe it's the ASM pass, right? So how can students use the buses, and where do they get their pass?
Yeah, definitely. So any bus that's over 80 is free for anyone to ride at any point. There are a lot of bus stops near residence halls. They're right on you'll be able to see them. But also if you use the Wisconsin app, you can see the bus schedules and see when everyone is running. And then if students are interested in getting the ASM bus pass, they just grab one from the union. It's super easy to get a bus pass there. Then they can ride the bus, you know, any of the buses for them. But if you, like a family, is hoping to ride around campus, any of the buses that are above the number 80, so 80, 81, 84, that'll take you around campus are all free for anyone to ride.
Perfect. Thanks again, Rachel. One tip I will say that's really cool is Google Maps is actually integrated with the Madison Metro bus schedule. So if you put that in on the app on your phone, literally you'll have an icon on the top that looks like a bus. You can push that and it literally shows you how to get anywhere. You can go to Target if you need to, run down the street, however you need to take care of that. So that's always a really huge little tip. So I think I'm going to try to sneak in about one more question here, or a couple. So Tanya, it's a lofting question. So this comes to us from Alex, and Alex is asking, how do you know which lofting mechanism you should use? So I think we showed that lofting page, and there's just some concerns like, which one do I use? How do I know? So if you're looking at that, how would you assess that?
Absolutely. And even more so in some of the halls, there might be two styles in the same room, depending on what you have. So if we could pull up that lofting guide again, looking at the tall uprights, that's our north furniture style. That's just one full length around 60 inches, 72 in some buildings, where it's just two headboards, two bed ends. And then you can move that bed spring and your mattress up and down as low or as high as it will let you go within those rings. So if you just have that one tall bed piece, you're going to know to follow the tall upright lofting process. For the stackables, it's really four bed ends that you'll see either square or kind of rectangle and sometimes round shapes at the end of the bed end, where you can see that they stack together. And then that requires an additional stabilizer bar to lock those pieces together. So if you see those extra parts there, then that's how you'll kind of see the stackable upright options. And those tall and stackables are intermixed in some of the spaces, so it'll be something to watch out for. Building block, that is specific to celery and waters only. So that right there is all you need to know in terms of the building block. We are obviously phasing out of these, the style, but that requires to utilize all the furniture in the room or most of it in some capacity to half loft or fully loft or trundle or whatever the configuration the students decide to utilize. And then just a really quick to add on to that, safety rails is a big question. And at least one safety rail is provided in all rooms for all beds. While we would not encourage lofting against near the window, it does happen. And so our request is at a minimum, there needs to be a safety rail facing the window side. So if an additional one is needed in your room, you can always request that through the facilities team. But at a minimum, everyone has at least one.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Tanya. So I just want to take a moment here and thank everyone for joining us. Believe it or not, that actually wraps up our session for this evening. So we know you guys may have some more questions. We do have some staff who are helping to answer those questions in the chat as we are still going here. So they'll still do that while we can. If you would like to see a recorded version of this chat afterwards, please do go to our Live with Bucky Live page. You can find that at go.wisc.edu/livewithbuckylive. If you think of something after this live stream has ended, please send it to us by filling out our contact us form. And you can go to that at go.wisc.edu/housing-contact. We will have staff checking email pretty much constantly as much as we can during move-in. But if there is an urgent issue and you need something, there are numbers on the residence hall doors for house fellows on call that can assist if you are here after hours. So if you're looking for more information, we can't believe it. Move-in is here in just a couple days. Here's a couple ways you can get that, right? One, spend some time exploring our website. We showed you some great resources today, our furnishings page, right, our moving and breaks page, and also explore your own hall page. There's information on there that can help you. If you have questions as well, be sure to explore our housing FAQ page, which is a great resource. We've got all sorts of different things listed there. That's at go.wisc.edu/housing-FAQs. Another thing I will point out is, so there's all sorts of stuff about vaccination and testing. And then up at the top is a link to the campus's FAQ page for COVID and other things. And that's a huge resource. So if you don't find the answer on ours, campus has got you covered. And they've got a great key there too to sort. Lastly, explore our previous Live with Bucky Live sessions. We have been so lucky to have a plethora of information we've brought to you every single week. And I guarantee you, if you have a question, we've most likely answered that in a session. So they're all sorted on that Live with Bucky Live page. So I have one more guest that wants to wish you a happy move-in. You probably saw him causing trouble behind me. His name is Sven. So he is excited for you to come to campus, and I'm going to bring the rest of our panelists in here, and they are so excited to have you come to campus as well. So thank you so much for being with us all these nights. We are so excited, and we cannot wait to have you on campus soon. So take care, everyone, and have a wonderful evening.